We continue in the appendicular skeleton with the upper limb, which consists of 30 bones. Running down one side of the body, the arm bone is the humerus. Moving distally, there are two forearm bones, the radius and ulna. Continue to move distally, and we run into the 8 wrist-boned, which are carpal bones, then 5 metacarpal bones deep to the palm, and 14 phalanges, which are finger bones. So we'll start with the humerus, which is the arm bone and the longest bone in the upper limb. There are a lot of landmarks on the humerus that we learn in lab, like the head at the proximal end, which is your ball portion of the ball and socket joint, which articulates with the glenoid cavity of the scapula. You have a greater tubercle and a lesser tubercle for muscle attachments and this intertubercular groove for your biceps tendon. On the diaphysis, there's a deltoid tuberosity for your shoulder muscle to insert onto. At the distal end, where the elbow is located, we have a capitulum where the radius articulates with, and the trochlea, which the ulna articulates with, which is the main part of your elbow. The two bones in the forearm include the ulna and the radius. The ulna is the medial bone in the forearm, and its major portion is at the proximal end where the elbow joint is located. The radius is the lateral bone of the forearm, and it articulates with most of the carpals. So if we look at an image, the ulna is dominant at the proximal or elbow end, and the radius is much larger and more prominent at the wrist or carpal end, which is the distal end. And again, there's a lot of good landmarks on these bones for labs. The olecranon process is the tip of your elbow. We have a coronoid process as well on the ulna. The radius has a head and a neck and a radial tuberosity. At the distal end, both radius and ulna have styloid processes on either end of the wrist. Moving distal down the upper extremity, we get to the carpus or carpal bones. Those are your wrist bones. There are 8 of them that exist in 2 rows. These are the carpal bones in the proximal row. These are the carpal bones in the distal row. And you should be able to locate which row they're in. We're going to see a picture in a minute. But moving distally, then we run into the metacarpal bones or metacarpus. These are 5 bones deep to your palm, numbered 1 to 5 from the thumb side using Roman numerals. Finally, at the distal end of the upper limb, we have finger bones called phalanges. Phalanx is singular for phalanges, which is plural. And we're going to look at an image to go through all of these bones in the hand that we went through. So here are your 8 carpal bones. So here's the proximal row, which we have the scaphoid, lunate, triquetrum, and on the triquetrum we have a pisiform. Those 4 bones make up the proximal row, reading left to right here, and then we'll do that again. Here we have the trapezium, the trapezoid, the capitate, and the hamate. And in lab we'll go into those in a little more detail and how to easily find their labels. Further distal, these are your 5 metacarpal bones, which are deep to your palm, which we just number 1 to 5. Here we have regular numbers. Often they're in Roman numerals. So 1 is on the thumb side. This is your 1st metacarpal all the way to your 5th metacarpal on the pinky finger side. The rest of the bones in the upper extremity are called phalanges, and you'll see that each digit has 1, 2, 3 phalanges, which we label the proximal, middle, and distal phalanx. Proximal, middle, distal phalanx. That happens on 4 of the digits, but on the thumb, there's only two phalanges. There is no middle, just a proximal and a distal phalanx. This will be identical in the toes, so it's a good idea to get these bones straight here, and that'll help you out a little later on.